He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D, Tony D'Angelo.
All right, welcome back. 6 minutes after the hour, 7 o'clock, and every Tuesday at the same time, we are lucky to get a chance to sit down and chat with the one and only Tony D'Angelo. You can follow him on Twitter, where he is a flat rock star, Tony D'Angelo 7. And, of course, on Thursday, he releases a YouTube video. Tony, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Lee Elci. Good morning, everybody, and proud to be among you. Did you see that riot yesterday? We're going to get to that in the second part of this discussion.
The riot?
Yeah, the riot on Twitter.
Oh, yeah. Yes. So, yeah, I can't wait for you to explain that to me.
Yeah, we'll get into that. Was having some fun with the esteemed political class. But, thank you very much for playing what you did yesterday morning, the sort of impromptu gathering we had with Rob Nevins. And it kind of gave me a different perception. And, Rob is absolutely right. We project outwardly, what we're really kind of germinating on inwardly. It's like food. It's like if you eat garbage food, you're going to look horrible, you're going to feel horrible, and vice versa. And when I go through my days, what Kathy was saying to me this past weekend, she says, I know when you're into it. I know when you're grinding and you're digging and you're finding things because it wears on you and it bears on you. And, of course, I get that, too. I get that in the practice. And, it's how could I put it? It bothers me because when you see waste, fraud, abuse, malfeasance, incompetence on one side, and you see a look the other way attitude on the other side, not everybody, but in a certain part, it's like, where do I go? What do I do? Because, you're just sitting there saying, a whole bunch of people saying, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. Now, the stupid stuff will catch up with you, and this is the thing. Like last week in Connecticut, we made libs of TikTok 3 times in one day. So it's like this is out there, and it does bear on you. And then the it's the Ed Norton law of the sewer. Water's always going to seek its own level. It's always going to find out some place to go. But when it was going through all the negativity, I saw hope, I saw hope in the fact that, because what do? We all try to push for a solution. The little discussion we had with Rob, and the light always shines through if you want to look at it. Now, one thing I looked at in just trying to see things to be hopeful about, and this was like hardly covered in the media, there is a major Jesus concert in New York City. Now, that to me, the Savior is my ultimate source of hope. I don't visit with them enough. And all these young people are out there saying, hey, there's something a whole lot more than like what the politicians are telling us and what the media is telling us. And, and it dawns on me, Lee Elci, it's like whenever you're in trouble, what's the first thing you say? Oh, God, right? God, yeah. You don't say, oh, Donald Trump or, oh, Ned Lamont or whatever the case may be. It kind of tells you something. So, it's like I sat there, I slapped myself in the head, and I said, even though I believe we do valuable information, we're looking for solutions, the solutions are much greater than what politics can give us. Politics has done nothing but screw things up day after day, year after year, with little glimpses in between. There's a large part of this discussion that I think since 2020 with the whole, COVID takeover, as I like to call it, we've gotten away from the positive stuff. And, I think it's time we start pointing ourselves back there and finding alternative ways of doing things, because a lot of what we see, what you're saying this morning, it just ain't working, pal.
Yeah. And you feel so much better being positive, right? If you have that day. I mean, that's sort of what Rob brings. And those of you who may have missed it, so yesterday, the lead play, and by the way, Tony could be the lead play just about every single week, so, because it, basically is on early and you guys get him early, he doesn't always get that, so, but playing that back of Rob and him just having a conversation about life and what's good in it and how you should perceive it, I think it was really, you know, it was inspiring. And I think it's great. And I think you guys sort of hit the nail on the head that there is something else out there. We don't have to always just be mired in the muck and the gloom and the doom all the time.
And people should treasure America because America allows us to be free people.
Yep.
If we, you know, if we cherish that freedom and not be dictated to by the lummoxes and the losers. But that's, I mean, not everybody can do that. But anyway, with that, you know, kind of being as it is, it dawned on me, you know, yesterday with the riotous time we had on Twitter. It's like, you know, revelation number two. Politics and politicians are, you know, never going to save America. Programs are going to make it worse. I mean, Connecticut's living proof of that. But people and policy, to me, are the only way to clean things up. And, you know, we don't get a lot of that here. But with that all said, a large part of freedom is economic freedom. And we had a development over the weekend. And this was covered, you know, at least I don't know what the, you know, the liberal media was doing, but they had a piece on Fox and there's an article in The Wall Street Journal. When Donald Trump, President Trump, was campaigning in Nevada, I don't know if he did this off the cuff or I don't know if he did it really thinking about it. Apparently his campaign staff said, you know, they never really, you know, got into the nuts and bolts of it. But he came and said, I am going to make a proposal that tipped wages are going to be tax-free.
Mm-hmm.
And that industry, you know, of course, it's all largely tip wages, a large part of it, and people went absolutely crazy. Now, the article in the Wall Street Journal is a little bit disingenuous and unimaginative, and the writers were Richard Rubin and Vivian Salama. Honestly, I'm reading it. I don't know how they got to write for the journal. But to be clear, this idea, I don't think he could do it on an executive order. He'd have to get Congress to line up with him. And I thought, wow, this is really something. I don't know, Lee Elci, if he even realized what kind of dynamite or potential dynamite he unleashed from his proposal. And I'm reading down this article, and it's actually kind of funny. They got this one guy here from the Yale University Budget Lab. His name is Ernie Tedeschi. He's a former Biden guy. You know, it's like, we need to think about the unforeseen consequences of this. It's almost like a bad monster movie. And, you know, anybody that's ever worked in a restaurant and run that kind of thing, I know George's family's in it. It's an administrative nightmare, the whole thing, to deal with. Now, the guy who's the head of the culinary union in Las Vegas, Ted Poppett, George, is like, well, I'm not accepting an economic proposal from a convicted felon. I mean, it's like, and this is really the whole thing. This is the nub of it. It's like, you know, and I felt like going to him and saying, do you work for the Connecticut State Republican Party? But it's the typical thing. You can't separate the idea from the man. Get away from the man. Is the idea good? And basically, it's like it kind of goes back and forth. The president of One Fair Wage, Saru Jaramayan, if I'm pronouncing that right, is saying, oh, this is pandering. Well, it doesn't solve the problem of economic instability and poverty and struggle. I'm not laughing at that these workers are facing right now. Well, number one, you know, if I'd say to this particular person, if you've got something better, what is it other than, you know, having like a forced minimum and putting another business burden on businesses and restaurants and making them close? Look at what's happening in California right now, you know, coming to a stupid state near you. And the other thing is, what is wrong with getting people more money to spend, especially when you've got a dead, stupid, and inept economy? Now, of course, if you went to King Governor Ned Lamont, the unaccountable, you know, a global legacy, he thinks the economy is great because all he has to do is just rip from the Treasury and run his business. That's nothing to do with the guy in the restaurant. But what I'm starting to look at here is, I think Trump might have hit on something that's like borderline genius, because it's this whole thing of our cities and our communities and our states are just so poorly, you know, cash starved. I mean, we went through fuel policy, how that gets through everything, you know, once again, government at work. But here we got a way to mainline cash into areas that need it. And, you know, we got to start looking at that because, and you hear in this article, you read a lot of stupid stuff. What if, you know, what, things are done in 100% tips and nobody will pay any taxes? Well, like, well, no, numbskull. Maybe you have, you know, a limit like 20% or something like that. People do sign tax returns under penalty of perjury, right? But, you know, and some of these policy people are just so, excuse me, damned idiotic. But so when I saw this, I started to think, what about what happens in a place like Connecticut? And how do people in Connecticut, you know, shall we say government, feel about such a thing? If the federal government comes out, think of it, and they say, no taxes on tipped wages, what's Connecticut going to do? Are they going to follow suit or are they going to double it? You know, and then I addressed it to the and this was a riotous discussion. We had a lot of good back and forth, you know, with people who were saying, yeah, you know, maybe we tweak it here. Maybe we move this kind of thing here. But of course, you know, you get silence and brain deadness from the political class, went to Democrats and said, I dare you to ask all these people you take to the press conferences and ask them if they're opposed to working for tax-free cash, you know, and how do you feel about that? Well, I know what your answer is going to be. And to the Republicans, this is your chance to do something. This is your chance to say, you know, we favor economic empowerment. Isn't that what Republicans are supposed to do? It's like Volkswagens or little cars that look like Beetles and you have like four in the four or something. That to me was the understanding of a Republican. But, you know, are you going to get all wound up in this administrative state? I mean, what about, you know, will you support reduced contributions to, you know, the state, the Sean Scanlon retirement plan, which I love so much, and the PFML law, have people provide for themselves and or understand the economic risk. What, you know, I mean, in a place where we really need hard change, who's willing to make those hard changes? And this is where the rubber meets the road. I mean, I don't want to be the politician coming out and saying, well, I disagree with the Trump economic proposal where you don't pay taxes. I think you should. How about that? I'm not even thinking politically, Lee Elci. I'm thinking economically, you know, and then take that one step further. Okay, well, I'll mention this much. We have two, we're blessed to have two esteemed gentlemen on this particular show, Colonel Simmons and Walter Way, and they both say the same thing. Tourism, culinary tourism. Okay, great. I'm with you. I agree with you. What better way? I'm sorry Bruce isn't into, I'd like to get his impressions of this. What better way to say, okay, our servers are going to be non-taxed on their tips, which, of course, is going to drive the restaurant expenses down, which will drive the cost of meals down, which will engender tourism and make a, you know, have an economic lifeline rather than regulating the hell out of it. I mean, there's something to do economically rather than having the CTDECD, another lecture for another time. Excuse me. But, you know, it's like, where else can we go with this idea? Well, look at our cities. You know, you mentioned on your excellent monologue how pathetic the cities are and how, you know, what we're seeing is like, I think New Haven's a perfect example. You have the cultural legacy elite on one side and you have the wreckage on the other. Well, it's not going to sustain like that. So why not, you know, make, you know, like there's one proposal. It's little known. It's in the Trump 2017 tax bill, the TCJA, called a qualified opportunity zone. And the idea was to invest in the city and to get a major tax break for doing it. That can all go bye-bye in 2025. Why not expand the opportunity zones to the city? You know, to the city itself, make people want to come. Now, if I'm sitting here, you know, comfortably in an upstate office and, you know, screaming about taxes and they say, well, you know, you can run your business in New Haven and pay no taxes or have a reduced tax rate, I've got a decision to make, you know, and it's like, and they're all floundering. They're all saying, well, you know, nobody's coming back to the cities. We can't get people, you know, we're daring them to come back to the offices. And it, well, it's like, well, how about giving them a little incentive to do that? Oh, no, we can't do that, you know, because that's contrary to our very being, you know. But it's just, these are the kinds of things that I think really that Trump really hit on, whether he realized it or not. Now, there's just like, there are so many places you can go with this thing. Now, you have to think about it. You have to think of the consequences. But the programs that we have, and the thing of forced economics, that's going to do nothing but to kill us and to cripple us and just make it, you know, continually bad for it. And I, you know, where we sit there and say, excuse me, what is the solution? Well, I mean, politics has failed. Government has failed or is barely hanging on. Why not give private capital an opportunity? Because I'll say this much. If you've got people whose economic substance is in a given area and it's worth it for them to do it, I mean, we'll keep everybody's nose clean. I mean, because basically that's where we, you know, we get our bread butter. And I mean, we'll put pressure on the government to make the government do what it needs to do, rather than the government trying to do something it can't do and failing miserably. I mean, I can go 10,000 ways with this thing, but it's really time that we started to think about something entirely different than the way we have. And I think Trump, with his little offhanded comment, if he's listening or if his people are listening, I think you got something here, folks, if you build on it and you know what to do with it.
You ever think, though, that because you're going to have to force this through you know, congressional. You can't just do an executive order, as you had said.
Right.
You know, they'd have to rewrite tax code. I can never imagine a day when they're going to give back free money or what they consider free money.
It's going to take a lot, but the hard question that you have to ask yourself is, politicians don't, the only politician I ever saw in my life that ever walked before the American public and said, I failed, I blew it, I should have been here, I wasn't, was Reagan during Iran-Contra. Everybody else has made some kind of excuse or run, or, you know, now it's easy to go back on the internet and find out the 15 things they did wrong with a little, you know, armchair trip on your dining room table, where years back you'd have to go to the library and go through the stacks and the Reader's Guide to Periodical Literature. But Reagan was the only one that did it. I mean, I am of a mind, Lee Elci, that I think that if people don't do that, we're going to be in a bigger mess than we are right now. Yeah, it's a lot, because it's constituencies. It's, you know, a Democrat go against a union? No, probably not. But yet a number of people saying, Democrat, we won't vote for you unless you do something to let us have more money in our pockets and make our energy costs cheaper. Yeah, that might do something. I was saying, I'm actually saying to our friend Fan Linda, one of the discussions we were having, and I don't know if it's one of the ones that, you know, you were involved with in one of the groups, but I said, you know, we did so much on this particular show about preserving the First Amendment and e-cars. Now, did we do every single thing? No, but it was our energy that pushed that thing forward. Others wanted to take credit for it, but it was like, you know, in Connecticut, yeah, they wanted to take away the First Amendment. A Republican senator wanted to take away the First Amendment, or in some kind of way, basically. And, you know, we spoke up about that, and, you know, that quickly died. I mean, people have a lot of power. People have a lot of initiative. These are the kinds of things you have to ask yourself. What makes my life better? How does this work? I'm not saying this is a perfect solution, but, man, no. It's a start.
Well, listen, I'm never going to say no to eliminating taxes. As, you know, you're speaking, I'm thinking to myself, all right, the original intent, I think, for the income tax was after the Civil War, 3% just to pay.
Yeah, and same debt. For World War One.
Right, yeah, so it was supposed to go away, and, you know, we know that, unfortunately, they never do. But, you know, you always are going to have a better economy if you have more money in your pocket, more money to spend, more discretional income to spend. You got, you know, businesses then can prosper and grow and then be forged. It's that trickle of the pond, the trickle effect, or the ripple in the pond effect. I mean, it affects everybody in a positive way.
Well, you know, and where you're seeing this now, you're seeing it in Hartford to varying degrees, but you're seeing this in Chicago with the deluge illegal immigrants, and you've got these men, a lot of them are pastors and people with businesses and things, saying, this is crazy. We've got to do something different. You know, there's America should be for Americans first. But the problem, you know, it dawned on me yesterday that these are men that probably, they're younger than I am, maybe they're in their mid-50s or, you know, whatever the case may be. They grew up during the Great Society, which basically was the biggest handout program known to mankind. Two things have survived from the Great Society, you know, Head Start and I think to a certain limited extent the Job Corps. Why? They have something to do with work, right? It's not real hard. But basically it's like they want to do something, but they don't know how. And that's really the tragedy. I mean, I think you got to get it to where you could show people how to do. I think once they figure out how and they could do something on their own, it would be a little bit of a different world. But you have to get all the nonsense and the crying and screaming justifying panderers out of the way. They're just not helping.
Tony D'Angelo. Follow him on the Twitter, TonyD'Angelo7. And, of course, on Thursday, he'll unleash yet another video. Tony, I got to run, but thank you, sir.
Thanks, pal.
All right, buddy. Tony D, and we get him every Tuesday. We're lucky to get him. Make sure you follow him on the Twitter. We'll come back. I got a stack of stuff to roll through. That'll come your way next.
From 6 until 10 on 94.9 News Now and stimulating talk.
Traffic alert on 94.9 News Now.
In Stonington, an accident, I-95 southbound approaching exit 91. The right lane is blocked. Stop and go traffic from exit 92. East line, the accident has cleared. I-95 northbound at exit 73. Slow traffic from exit 72. No delays heading over the Gold Star Bridge. Route 12 slow in both directions in Groton. Route 32 stop and go northbound by the Coast Guard Academy. Northbound again in Quaker Hill and slow northbound in Montville. No delays on I-395. I'm Eddie Schaefer, Time Saver Traffic.
Time Saver Traffic is brought to you by Eastern Connecticut Savings Bank, home of Kasasa Checking. Visit BankEasternCT.com.
Do you have your eye on the economy? The good news is, at Charter Oak Federal Credit Union, we do too. Take advantage of our limited-time offer share certificates. You can earn 4.75% annual percentage yield for 8 months or 4.25% APY for 30 months.